will be going. Will she hit the third anniversary of becoming Prime Minister in the middle of July? That will depend on how quickly the Conservative Party is able to complete the selection contest for their next leader. Let's get some reaction now from Labour's Rupa Huq MP and also from the editor of Brexit Central, Jonathan Isaby. Your feeling, your reaction to Mrs. May saying she's going in a matter of weeks?
I mean, it was a long time coming, wasn't it? Theresa May was on life support for quite a long time, and that old phrase of being in office but not in power. So, I mean, the inevitable has happened, and it's her own party who's done her in at the end of the day. They are the nasty party.
You are obviously her opponent. You want her gone. Do you have any sympathy for her?
I mean, as a human being, potentially, but I think everything that she had coming to her actually came to fruition. She boxed herself in very early with those red lines in January 2017, you're right, Adam. Yeah, she set these parameters, then there was no room for manoeuvre. And then she only ever negotiated with the DUP and the ERG. I mean, by the time those cross-party talks happened in April, I was in with her April the 4th, she had got fixed into this pattern of stubborn intransigence, and there just comes a time when being a bloody difficult woman is a liability, not a strength anymore.
Jonathan, as we heard it there, you know, she's been done in by the nasty party.
Well, going back to what she did in January 2017, when she gave that Lancaster House speech, she actually set out a vision of Brexit which commanded great support in the Conservative Party and, I think, in the wider country too. And Rupa says that she was stubbornly intransigent. The problem was that during the course of those negotiations with Brussels, she breached pretty much all of those red lines that she did set herself at Lancaster House, so that she ended up with this deal that satisfied absolutely
nobody. Which red lines did she breach? Because she still says we'd be leaving the customs union, we'd be leaving the single market, we'd have control of our borders, we'd have control of our money, we'd cease paying fees to the European Union. Those were her red lines, and her deal still has it there, and yet it wasn't good enough.
I mean, fundamentally, the Northern Irish backstop in the deal that she negotiated potentially leaves the UK beholden to the EU and in a permanent customs union with the European Union, which would not represent leaving the European Union.
The customs union wasn't on the ballot paper. We don't know what it was people voted for, and that's the difficulty of having question on a multiple choice
thing. It was quite clear from both sides during the referendum that taking back control of our trade policy was part of what people voted for. You cannot leave the European Union but still have the European Union making our trade policy.
Didn't even enter into the debate. So, I mean, yeah, it's a sorry end to someone who wanted to extinguish burning injustices. They're burning all over the place still. I mean, and her legacy will be a very sorry one. She had one job, she didn't deliver on that. We're in an extension to an extension. The UN rapporteur has said that human rights are being breached, extreme poverty, our fellow citizens are in. It's a bit of a sorry end, really.
Jeremy Corbyn and Nicola Sturgeon have both called for an immediate general election. But given we are where we are, there's not much point in doing that, is there?
Well, I think there needs to be some kind of democratic event as the only way out of this, because we're in legislative logjam. Parliament is paralysed, so something's got to shift. We've got 650 MPs who don't want anything really bad to happen in the sense of no deal, but at the same time, they're unagreed with what they will allow to happen. Either we need a general election to elect 650 new ones who can decide something, or we need a people's vote, a confirmatory referendum on whatever is decided at the end of all this. Now this is in disarray. We've got, I mean, her cabinet has been a collection of leadership contests for quite a long time, if any of them opens their mouth. And that seems to change the cabinet composition on a weekly basis. Gavin Williamson was there 1 minute, then he's gone. Andrea Leadsom only this week. I think it's been a pretty shambolic record. It's been record-breaking because she has had two of the biggest defeats ever. Record-breaking in the sense that she's had the most resignations ever. I think it's a sorry end to what used to be an election-winning machine.
One gets the sense that the faction that you support in Brexit Central and Taxpayers Alliance and the rest of it, the faction of MPs, they're afraid of any sort of other vote because they don't want to test their strength with the voters.
I think the last thing that we need is another democratic test, as Rupa puts it. We had a referendum which had more people voting for Brexit than ever voted for anything in electoral history. Hold on. The general election in 2017, where 85% of people voted for parties committed to delivering Brexit, and just this week, we've had European elections, the results of which we won't get until Sunday, where by all accounts, people expect the Brexit Party to top the poll with a very clear agenda. Now, if that won't be a clear message to the politicians over the road, I don't know what will be.
But the fact is, we've got a divided country. I suspect the Brexit results will show that, the election results when we get them will show that. And Parliament is tied as well. So why not have another democratic exercise? We hear a great deal from the Brexit faction about democracy, yet they seem to be the ones resisting it, either in a referendum or a general election.
But you say the country is divided. You're a believer in the will of the people.
Well, it is.
Well, by the nature of any election or referendum, you're not going to have 100% of people voting the same way. But consistently, people have voted in favour of Brexit, and they want to see it delivered. And what they're seeing is too many politicians in Parliament who are unwilling to deliver on that result.
Well, let's bear in mind, elected politicians. Politicians, they elected to do a job.
60% of people in Ealing Central and Acton elected me because they thought I would resist Brexit. So, I mean, it's a complete fallacy to say 80% of people wanted Brexit. We have consistently voted against the EU withdrawal bill. And that was an inconclusive election. She lost her majority, just like she lost 1,300 councillors the week before last. I mean, it's been a pretty calamitous reign. And as I say, an ignominious end to someone who came in with high ideas.
All right, now let's move on to the Conservative Party. You follow the Conservative Party very closely. How do you see the choices emerging on the next leader of the Conservative Party and by default the next Prime Minister?
And clearly there's a very crowded field with over a dozen names being talked about as serious contenders. And not actually that many people have come out to declare for candidates at this stage. So it is a very, very open field. The danger of Boris Johnson is that he's the bookies' favourite. In any Tory leadership election in the modern era, the favourite has never won, the person who was expected to at the beginning. So anything could happen, frankly. In terms of the final result, I think you will see a final two go to the country, of whom one will be someone who backed Brexit from the beginning, the other person likely to be someone who backed Remain but who has reconciled themselves to supporting Brexit, which is what Theresa May said her position was. My instinct would be that amongst the Tory party members, they will vote for the person who was the early Brexiteer in that contest, because they saw Theresa May make the pledge that she would deliver, but I'm afraid she hasn't.
It's not your party, but from, you know, your position closely observing it, how do you think this Conservative leadership race is going to pan out?
I mean, more internecine strife from this divided party. She's divided the country, families, her cabinet, and just they're playing to the gallery at the moment. This entire exercise has been about keeping their party together, having a referendum in the first place. Everything that's happened since is sort of, and it's not just fraying, it's completely fractured. There are people that are advocating no deal when they know that every government analysis of every sector of the economy, every region of our nation shows it will be a catastrophe.
Well, the government analysis said that the result of the vote to leave.
I'm not finished what I'm saying, actually. And they are scared of democracy, because a democratic renewal, they talk about the will of the people, that is what this country needs. Either we go back to the people in a general election, that one was inconclusive, or we have a people's vote.
Who would be the worst person from Labour's point of view to emerge as Tory leader and Prime Minister? Some people say you would fear Boris Johnson most. Is that true?
I mean, I think they're all pretty unpalatable and uninspiring. Boris Johnson, I think, is quite dangerous. He's been on manoeuvres for some time. He's used his weekly Telegraph column to fan the flames of Islamophobia and attack women, vulnerable women. He doesn't mind doing that as long as his leadership ambitions are advanced by it. So, I mean, he's someone we know that he wrote two columns and then took the calculation about whether to be an inner or an outer, took the calculation that that's what the membership wants. And that membership is a tiny rump now compared to our 500,000 members. It's, what, 100,000 people that are at the extreme fringes of politics in this country, and they are choosing our next Prime Minister. I think it's bad for democracy.
Could hardcore Brexiteers ever support Boris Johnson, given that he was a bit of a late arrival to the party?
Look, he supported Vote Leave from the beginning of the referendum campaign, albeit in terms of the third meaningful vote, he backed the government's deal, but then so did other leading contenders as well. You know, Boris Johnson is clearly a serious contender, as is Dominic Raab, Esther McVeigh, another Brexiteer. Penny Morden, we haven't heard a lot about, but she might be a dark horse contender as well from that Brexiteer faction.
It's all a bit mad, isn't it? Here we are, we haven't decided what to do about Brexit, and yet the Tory party, having precipitated a leadership election, doesn't know who it wants to lead it.
well, clearly you have an election to make that choice, and that's why that choice needs to be made sooner rather than later. And I think it's essential they do get someone in place by the time of the summer recess, because that person can then go to Brussels with a mandate from the Conservative Party membership to make some demands of Brussels.
OK, we're going to have to leave it there. Let's get the latest reaction now from the environment.